Okay, so let's start Professor Frandri's lecture four. Please start.
Thank you very much. This is the last two lectures, number four and five, are both devoted to this topic, transport noise. So let me, in a sense, the next slide summarizes what we have done until now. In the first lecture, you remember, I insisted on the physical origin of additive noise that is, I mean, there could be different physical origins, and the one that I have indicated maybe is still under debate, is still to be understood better. But I insisted on the fact that a good viewpoint could be that noise is created at the boundary. And in the next lecture, in the second lecture, the noise from additive became state dependent. And so the mathematical theory from additive noise that can be studied as a completely deterministic problem, if one like, moved to stochastic equations. And the third lecture was more on the techniques to deal with the stochastic equation. So until now, we did additive noise and state-dependent noise. And now we start this last part of the last two lecture, in which I want to introduce this other kind of noise, transport, explain the physical origin and consequences, especially at the level of turbulence theory. The two lectures today and next week are mixed. Instead of doing first all the motivation and then the mathematical theory or vice versa, I will mix a little bit. So something written here appears also today, and something else will appear next time. I noticed after having shared the slides that next slide is already a little bit too technical in the sense why speaking about this now. So maybe if you accept this, I will write by hand a sort of intermediate slide to clarify the picture. The picture is that we are dealing, of course, with Navier-Stokes equations, which is a time derivative of velocity. And then there are other terms. This is not the point now. Other terms. And additive noise means that we have the time derivative of a function which is not very regular. Then, and this was the additive. Then we moved to state dependent. Noise, which means that this time derivative is multiplied by functions of the solution U. The transport noise that I'm going to introduce, if one wants, is a particular case of state dependent, but is so particular that deserves an independent name. Because as a function of u, it is precisely the gradient of u, nothing else than the gradient of u for precise physical reasons. So the gradient of u is multiplied by the time derivative of this irregular function. This is the transport noise. There are details that we will clarify during the talk, namely that the multiplication between the gradient and this time derivative has to be clarified. It could be Stratonovich but this is a technical detail that I will describe. Another technical detail is that physically, from the physical viewpoint, this term should appear on the other side, just after the time derivative of u. Namely, these two terms together have a physical meaning. They are a sort of material derivative. Material together, if we put together the time the partial derivative of u plus this noise term, this has a meaning of material derivative. I will explain in a second what I mean, and this is just to, this clarifies two facts. One fact, which is completely secondary, is that sometime here you will see a sign minus, because we are on the right-hand side of the equal, and this term should appear with the plus on the left-hand side of the equal. But this, of course, is a secondary detail, because Brownian motion in law is symmetric with respect to change of sign, and so calling Brownian motion W or minus W is the same. So this is just a secondary detail. But the point is that since that is a material derivative, the algebraic shape gradient of u times noise is mandatory. It cannot be a nonlinear function of the gradient, or a generic function of gradient and u. This does not have the meaning of material derivative. So that is mandatory, that kind of a precise shape. The equations that I will discuss during this talk and the next one are not only the Navier-Stokes, but also the transport of heat, temperature. So I will consider both the Navier-Stokes as we did until now. Sorry, let me change the color because it's not very readable. We will treat both Navier-Stokes and the heat transport. Because I think that for many reasons is very important to see them together now. Until now, it was not so important, but now it's very important. Heat transport means that there is a new quantity that I call theta. The meaning of this new quantity is a temperature in our lectures. Temperature. I don't use the letter capital T, because capital T is also the time zero capital T, so there will be confusion. So I use theta, and the equation for the temperature is that there is the variation in time of the temperature is equal to a diffusion constant times Laplacian of the temperature. So the temperature diffuses, the heat diffuses. And this heat is in a fluid. So we have a warm fluid. The heat, the temperature is also transported by the motion of the fluid. If the fluid moves, a mass of fluid from a position to the other, the heat of this mass moves. And this is described by the term velocity of the fluid times gradient of theta. And this sum is the so-called material derivative. This is the total derivative of theta as a function of time. And in the position, I do not write x, the so-called Eulerian coordinate, but I write x of t, the so-called Lagrangian, namely, I think that we have the fluid, the domain D of the fluid. We consider points which move. Points which move due to the velocity of the fluid. Due to the velocity, the points of the fluid move through the domain, call x of t the position of a point starting from a position x0, and the total derivative is the partial derivative of theta in time plus the gradient of theta scalar x point of t. But now the question is, what is x point of t? If x point of t is the velocity of the fluid at time t and the position x of t, then we find the sum written here. And so this algebraic structure is mandatory. We cannot change at our pleasure. And the philosophy of this transport noise, roughly speaking, but I hope to be much deeper than this, but roughly speaking, the philosophy is that this W is a sort of additional contribution to the velocity. So the velocity of the fluid has its own, let's say, main value plus a random contribution which makes the fluid more complex, more turbulent. But I will be much more precise later. This is just the first intuition from the algebraic viewpoint to collocate the algebraic term, gradients, noise, etc., inside continuum mechanics. In continuum mechanics, we have the total derivative, we have velocity times gradient of, and in the case of heat transport, in the case of heat transport, the interpretation is very clean. Namely, we have a velocity field U. In the heat transport, we have a velocity field U. And the idea is that we use as a velocity field the noise. Of course, this is a simplification. The velocity field which acts on the temperature should be solution of Navier-Stokes, etc. But one could say, let's make a simple model in which the velocity field is noise. So this is this interpretation is very simple and relatively clean. Much more difficult is a similar argument inside the Navier-Stokes equation, because the sort of a paradox is the Navier-Stokes equation already describes the velocity of the fluid, and we pretend to add an additional component of velocity of the fluid, which is noise. We pretended to put noise as an additional component to the velocity, but the U here is already the velocity. So what is going on? And this is why, if I go back to the slide, the previous slide that I just showed, this is why here there is the sentence, let me underline with another color, small scale, small, large scale decomposition. Namely, the velocity fluid, to anticipate the idea, the velocity fluid has large scales and small scales, so it is not only a unique object, the velocity fluid. And so if we consider it as a sum of two objects, one object will be the U solution of Navier-Stokes, the other object will be noise. So this is the idea why, in a sense, there are two velocity fields, one of them being noise, is because we think to the general idea of fluid dynamic of large scales, small scales decomposition. This is an anticipation of the main ideas, apart from mathematics, the main ideas of the talk. And but now there is a technical point which is the which is there is some noise, but I'm not worried about, but that's I didn't know if it was a question or so. Thank you. So now there is a technical question that we have to solve first, which is the following one. So I go back to this handwritten notes to explain the technical question. Technical question is, take the heat equation, which is easier. So take the heat equation. Let me rewrite just to clarify, because heat equation, I rewrite what I wrote before. Time derivative of the temperature plus velocity field gradient of the temperature equal to some kind of dissipation of the temperature. Now the point is U, the velocity field, is not in general the time derivative of an irregular function W. It's not a white noise. This is exaggerated, so to speak. This view is slightly exaggerated. What we have in mind is that U is a regular field. It's a regular field. Maybe it is interesting to study the limit, namely taking a regular field with very fast oscillations in time, like a turbulent field. You remember the first picture of my first lecture was an experimental picture of the randomness of signals in turbulent fluids. So a turbulent fluid may have a signal which is very similar to white noise, but not strictly speaking white noise. It's a smooth function which is just very irregular. And so the question is, if we consider regular fields, and then we take the limit to white noise, time derivative of Brownian motion. So the time derivative of Brownian motion is considered as a limit and not as a data a priori by choice. Which kind of equation we find? Which is the correct equation with the white noise? The answer is, I anticipated above, that the answer is that here we need the operation called Stratonovich that we discussed already in one of the previous lecture. For every time there is a state-dependent noise, there is the question of Stratonovich erasing. In the previous lecture, when I introduced Stratonovich and I said that there is a correction, at the end of the story, this correction didn't play so much a role. I mean, it was simply to be correct from the physical viewpoint. I insisted there is, you consider white noise as a limit, and therefore the interpretation is Stratonovich. Stratonovich means that if you rewrite Stratonovich as Ito, there is a correction. But it was more a remark in the past. In these two lectures, in the lecture of today and next time, the correction between Stratonovich and Ito is everything. All my lectures are based on the fact that this is Stratonovich and there is a correction. If we miss this, if we underestimate this detail, we miss everything. And so I think that this is such a key point that I need to spend 20 minutes or more on this. What does it mean? It means that I go back to the concept of regular field which approximate white noise. And I spend four slides on this concept. And then we do the limit to Stratonovich, and then we go on. So this is an explanation of the next slides that I put the slides in a way that is perhaps not very clean a priori. So the story, to repeat, is that we introduce a transport noise opposite to the previous lectures, but the transport noise requires a special interpretation, which is Tratonovich. Now the special interpretation is so important that I cannot put as a secondary remark, and therefore I want to devote some slides precisely to approximation of Brownian, approximation of white noise and Stratonovich, because of the importance. And therefore we come to the next slide. The next slide want to show the following, that what we understood from the first lecture, namely noise at the boundary, in a sense is in the right direction, gives us a good viewpoint about this limit that I'm describing. So let us take this equation as a model of the fluid near the boundary. It is almost correct. The main mistake is that I do not put here the term U grad U. It's a big mistake. When we neglect this term, we are talking about the Stokes model. Indeed, we did in the first lecture, and second, we introduced the Stokes model and we analyzed the Stokes model. So this is precisely a Stokes model. A Stokes model in which there is additive noise. This noise is purely additive. So it's like in the first lecture, it represents these new vortices that are introduced. But as I stressed in the second lecture, these new vortices introduce energy, and so we have to subtract energy by some kind of a friction, of dissipation. And this is precisely done with this term here. This term here introduces dissipation. And I choose here a special compensation with parameters 1 over epsilon, 1 over epsilon. It's a very special choice. Many of you that do stochastic analysis would ask immediately why, if I choose here 1 over epsilon, why here I don't choose 1 over square root of epsilon, which is the most common scaling considered in stochastic analysis. I have to use, I cannot use this, I don't want to use this common scaling. I use precisely the scaling 1 over epsilon, 1 over epsilon, for the reason that will be clear in the next slides. So let me repeat, these slides presents a very simplified model of the fluid dynamic near the boundary. Creation of vortices, immediate dissipation of energy, and balance, so to speak, a sort of balance between these phenomena. Here the equation is just rewritten, so what we read here is just the same equation as before, in which I stress that the solution U depends on epsilon. And then I write the equation in mild form. We have done for Stokes equation, we have done precisely this. We wrote in mild form using the generator of the semigroup, which is just the Laplacian, so to speak, but is the projection of the Laplacian times the viscosity. And there is now this additional minus 1 over epsilon that you see it appears when we write the mild form. Secondary remark, this alternatively, secondary remark, you remember in chapter 1, we didn't want to use Ito integrals, and therefore we interpreted the time derivative of Brownian motion by integration by parts. And so we could do here also the integration by parts on the notes, of chapter 3 that are on the web. There is the formula made by integration by parts. But now we are more advanced, we use it to integrals, so it is not necessary to integrate by parts, and we can write the mild formula with the Itô integral. And now the point is analyze this mild formula when epsilon goes to zero. It's convenient to introduce notations. This, of course, requires to remember some notation later, but it's convenient. So U epsilon was the velocity. The velocity. Let me write here. This is velocity. The velocity of the fluid. I introduced the integral of the velocity, which does not have a great physical meaning, but I introduce and call W epsilon. At the same time, as we did many times in the previous lectures, we give a name W to the noise, the sum of the coefficient sigma kx times the Brownian motion Wk. We give a name W. Of course, you see the coincidence between these two names is not casual. The coincidence is because in the next slide we show that W epsilon converges to W. So to anticipate the next computation, I'm going to show that the time integral of the velocity field converges to the Brownian motion of the equation. Therefore, the same, written in a sort of more intuitive language, the velocity field U epsilon, in a sense, converges to the time derivative of the Brownian motion. Okay, this is conceptually the idea. The velocity field of the fluid at the boundary converges to a white noise, a time derivative of the Brownian motion, if we investigate a special scaling between the parameters. I wrote a paper with Umberto Pappalettera, one of my young collaborators, in which we tried to explain the physical meaning of this special scaling, 1/ε, 1/ε, but I believe that in the explanation of that paper, but I think I don't want to enter this kind of discussions, so to speak. So let us accept that such a scaling could be one of the interesting scaling to analyze. Maybe there are others more interesting. Could be one of the interesting scaling to analyze. In that scaling, the velocity field at the boundary converges to a white noise. Let us see mathematically why. So from the definition, from this definition, W epsilon is the time integral of the formula of the previous slide. I only made, let me go to the previous slide, sorry, because I want to show. In the previous slide, there was also an initial condition. This initial condition does not play any special role, so I put it zero, so it's not essential. So I take these stochastic integrals, U epsilon is given just by these stochastic integrals, and now I integrate in time these stochastic integrals. Then here to here, it is Fubini. I interchange this integration. There is a stochastic Fubini theorem. If we don't like the stochastic Fubini theorem, we do, as I said in the previous slide, we integrate by parts the noise, so that all integrals become just Riemann integrals. We apply Fubini and the bag integrals apply Fubini and is completely rigorous, but there is also stochastic Fubini theorem that can be applied. After the Fubini theorem, we can integrate the semigroup and arrive to this expression. And in the next slide, this expression is rewritten, splitting this minus. So what is written here in this slide, I rewrote to have always under our eyes the definition of W epsilon and W. I rewrote the result of the computation of W epsilon, which is really, really elementary. Simply I go a little bit fast, and let us analyze this result. What is written here? This term is the famous object in semigroup theory, the so-called Yoshida approximations. Instead of 1 over epsilon, we write lambda, which goes to infinity, is more intuitive. The Yoshida approximation is lambda times lambda minus the generator minus 1. And in the theory of semigroups, it is proved that under extreme generality, much more, we have a particular case. Our semigroup is a self-adjoint, compact resolvent, so we can use a complete orthonormal system of the Hilbert space to represent the operator. We have a lot of simplification, but this is a general fact of semigroup theory that this object, lambda times lambda minus a minus 1, converges to the identity in the strongest sense over every point of the Hilbert space. It converges to the identity. And therefore, first piece of result, this second term converges to minus, there is a minus, WT. Minus WT. And this is the end of the story. Now we have to understand the first term, which goes to zero. But the end of the story is that W epsilon converges to. Maybe I should have introduced a minus somewhere. Otherwise, it's not beautiful that W epsilon converges to minus W. I didn't notice this defect of the minus. It's always due to the fact that sometime I write the transport term on the right-hand side of the equal, something else on the left-hand side, and sometimes I do this minor mistake of sign, which is easily corrected. And the first part, this first part, goes to zero because it is made again of the Yoshida approximation, which goes to the identity. By the way, the Yoshida approximations are a modification of this object which converges to the generator A. Sorry, to be precise, the name Yoshida approximation refers, sorry, this is just because people that know well semigroup theory would be find unpleasant this fact. If you introduce the operator A in this position of the object, the limit has an A here. So these are the usual Yoshida approximation of the generator A. But forgetting about A, this object converts to identity, and let me call them Yoshida approximation for simplicity. So let me go back to what I was saying. Here we have again the Yoshida approximation that converges to identity, and if we investigate these integrals, are infinitesimal, for instance, in mean square, because of this factor 1 over epsilon. The semigroup, thanks to 1 over epsilon, becomes like a delta Dirac, but here there is no factor in front which produces the delta Dirac. So it's like a function which converges, this semigroup is like a function which converges to delta Dirac, but without increasing the height, just maintaining the height to 1. And so, in fact, it converges to 0. In the sense of Lebesgue function, it converges to 0. So it's a simple exercise to show that this goes to 0. So this term goes to 0. And therefore, the result the result summarized here is that the result is summarized in this lemma, W epsilon converges to W. Sorry, I had to change a minus somewhere, otherwise I should write W epsilon converges to minus W. But this is
I think the sign is correct.
Ah, the sign is correct.
I think one page before. That converges to plus WT because A minus 1 over epsilon, therefore.
Ah, thank you okay. Very much. Thank you very much. Let me
no mistake.
And show what you say to everybody, that you are completely right. sorry for my confusion. Let me clean. Here, thank you very much. Here, it is A minus compared to this, I changed the order. Speaking, I forgot to notice this. So the sign is correct. Here there is a minus, but here there is reversed what is written below here. So it's correct. So this is not a minus. It converges to plus W. Thank you very much for this remark and for my confusion. And so at the end of the story, let us summarize. We have the model, this model of a velocity fluid near the boundary. It's very simplified, extremely simplified. Any people in continuum mechanics would criticize the absence of the nonlinear term, and it would be very difficult for me to defend this choice. I could have some argument, but it's very difficult. So extremely simplified of velocity fluid at the boundary. Another very special choice is this scaling, but when we accept these two facts, we see that we have this theorem, which was already interpreted, but let me repeat. Intuitively speaking, is interpreted as U epsilon converging in a suitable sense to the time derivative of the Brownian motion. This is the philosophy of this part of work. Now we put this story, this approximation, inside the heat equation. I have anticipated this in the handwritten part at the beginning of the lecture. So we have the heat equation. We take U equal U epsilon above, and we analyze the limit when epsilon goes to zero of the solution theta epsilon. So now the theta becomes a theta epsilon, so we have the derivative of theta epsilon plus U epsilon gradient theta epsilon equal is diffusion constant plus theta epsilon. When epsilon goes to zero, I want to show that theta epsilon converges in a suitable sense to a function theta, which solves this equation. This equation is, of course, time derivative dissipation. And here we have the gradient of theta, like here above the gradient of theta, times our noise. Our noise is the time derivative of W, and time derivative of W is the time derivative of W is a sum over k, sigma k, time derivative of WK. All of this, let me recall, is if I put together these objects, all of this is the time derivative of W. So when U epsilon, when epsilon goes to zero, U epsilon converges to time derivative, U epsilon converges to time derivative of W, theta epsilon converges to theta solution of this equation. Fundamental, absolutely fundamental, is the interpretation here of this symbol, Stratonovich operation. But as I did already in a previous lecture, instead of introducing Stratonovich in itself, which I like very much, by the way, when very often when I give lectures to my students, I introduce Stratonovich in itself. I decided not to add also this additional element to this lecture to avoid too many. So for me, Stratonovich is a name for the sum of two terms, enito plus a correction. Okay, so this is why probably we will never see Stratonovich in itself. I name Stratonovich the sum of enito plus a correction. So the key point now is to understand which is the correction. And if I explain what is Stratonovich, then I could do, let's do the theory of Stratonovich, the general results on Stratonovich related to it, this and that. No, I don't follow this. I try to prove this theorem, the theorem written in this slide, namely that when u epsilon goes to white noise, theta epsilon goes to the solution of a certain equation. The complete proof is complicated, but I will give some element. But before, let me say with formula what I just said. Stratonovich is just a name for me. I will interpret it as Ito plus a correction, plus a correction. So, essentially, what I will try to show is that the original equation of heat equation with u epsilon converges to this equation. I name Stratonovich, but the equation is this one, where there is Ito plus a correction. And the key point is to understand that this correction is a second order elliptic operator. At the end, this second order elliptic operator has tremendous consequences. So all the story of these two lectures is in this second order elliptic operator. This is why I spend so much time to clarify that it really emerges from continuum mechanics with the simplification. I simplified continuum mechanics using Stokes' problem because I'm not able to do better at present. Maybe next year we will be able to do better. But really, from continuum mechanics and the limit arguments, there is a second order elliptic operator which emerges. It's not a trick of stochastic analysis that deterministic people cannot accept. It's a limit of smooth objects. Here there are additional remarks that immediately show the importance of this second order operator. Take the expected value of this theta, of this limit heat theta. Since we said already many times the expected value of Ito is zero, under some assumption, but morally is zero, we used this tremendous cancellation, is a tremendous property of cancellation, then the stochastic term here of this equation disappears if we take expected value. And we find this deterministic equation for the mean value. And this deterministic equation contains the old dissipation plus an additional dissipation. It is what is called the eddy diffusion in fluid mechanics. Is something that is observed in experiments. So it is true, it's nature. In nature, we know that when a fluid is turbulent, and the model u epsilon that I described is the model of a turbulent fluid with many vortices produced very fast, destroyed by an additional dissipation of energy, and so there is a continuous creation and destruction of vortices. We have a turbulent fluid. We take a special limit when epsilon goes to zero. we find a deterministic, we find first a stochastic equation interpreted in this Stratonovich sense, if you want, but there is this additional elliptic operator emerging. If we take expected value, this expected value satisfies an equation with an additional dissipation. By the way, what I'm telling here is not a discovery of the last year. These ideas appear in papers and books 20 years ago for the heat equation, But I will try to extend some of these ideas to, instead of the heat equation theta, the Navier-Stokes equation itself. And then, in this case, these ideas are essentially new in the application inside the fluid inside the Navier-Stokes equation itself are essentially new. So something is old ideas and something is new ideas. Anyway, there is this eddy diffusion that comes out. Now, let me ask you a little technical effort, which is, I want to explain this Wong-Zakai result. You remember one of the previous lectures, I already did a very simple Wong-Zakai result for a one-dimensional stochastic equation with separated variables. Here the framework is extremely more difficult because it is a partial differential equation. The noise appears in multiplicative form against the gradient, so it's much more difficult. And I want to show that the solution theta epsilon of this equation converges to the solution of this other equation with the additional elliptic L. And this is much more difficult. It is a rigorous theorem. I will give a few lines of that theorem. Even in the notes, I didn't report the full proof of the rigorous theorem. It's too long. But I give a reference and I describe a few lines of the proof. These few lines are sufficient to understand that this elliptic operator L should be there. It's absolutely mandatory to have the elliptic operator there. U epsilon, we wrote already the mild form, is this one. Here I rewrote again the two equations just to have them under our eyes all the time. The theorem is that under some regularity, but regularity of what? The sigma k, we know they are the coefficient of the mass. Phi is a test function. This result requires a test function. One can do something else, but using complicated negative Sobolev spaces, maybe not necessary, but okay, well, one can improve this result without test function, but with test function is particularly key. Without test function, it is a little bit more. So take a test function, apply the theta epsilon solution of the first equation to the test function, apply the theta of the limit equation, and the theorem says that there is a convergence. If I remember well, is even in mean square, but at least to be safe, let's say probability there is a convergence of theta epsilon to theta in this weak sense against the test functions, and also something more with special topologies. And the operator L, for the first time, I write this second order differential operator L. There is a minor mistake, sorry, there is one half, a factor. there is a factor 1/2 in front. I don't know why I forgot this 1/2. You remember in the Stratonovich corrector always have a 1/2 in front. So there is a 1/2 in front. The differential operator is made of this sigma k gradient that appeared also before, iterated. So we iterate sigma k gradient, sigma k gradient. Okay, this is the second order differential operator that appears into the equation. Let me give an idea of proof. First, something which is interesting in itself is that the solution theta epsilon of the approximating problem has a lot of estimates, which are almost deterministic. These two estimates are almost deterministic, in spite of the fact that the equation for theta epsilon, let me go one slide back, the equation something, otherwise we don't see anything. The equation for theta epsilon written here, contains u epsilon, and u epsilon, if I go another slide back, is a stochastic object. U epsilon is written here at the end, is a stochastic object. So there is a stochastic object appearing in the equation for theta epsilon. In spite of this, theta epsilon satisfies deterministic bounds thanks to the particular shape of the noise appears in transport. The noise is transport. Let me recall that the noise u epsilon appears against a gradient of theta epsilon, and this particular algebraic shape has consequences at the level of energy estimates and the maximum principle. And therefore, there are fantastic uniform estimates of the solution. Unfortunately, these are not sufficient, and this is the part that I drop because it's too technical. If you want to control theta epsilon t minus theta epsilon s increments in time, and these are necessary to complete the proof, to control this theory, these are much more difficult. So the norms in which one can control this and the bounds on this are much more difficult, and they are epsilon dependent and random. So only something is so simple. Something else is random and epsilon dependent, and so requires a lot of care in the mathematical investigation. But let's drop some detail and go on. Then, as I said, I try to take the limit in the weak sense, so against a test function. So when we integrate, when we take a scalar product between u epsilon gradient of theta epsilon, which is the most difficult term. If we want to take a limit in the weak sense, the difficult term is this one. And so let me analyze the difficult term. I take this against the test function, scalar product of L2, and then I also integrate in time. But this one, just this one, is minus, integrating by parts, it is minus theta epsilon scalar u epsilon gradient phi. And this is why here I take theta epsilon scalar u gradient phi, because I work in the weak sense. The advantage is clear. The advantage is that I take the derivatives only of the test function, and so I don't need so much regularity of theta and u. With the moderate regularity of theta and u, I can go on in the computations. Then I integrate in time, and I have to analyze the limit of this object. The first step is this one. We split the integral in time on a small time interval. So we take a partition of 0t, and we split the integral in time in small time interval. Then for notational simplicity, I do not want the several Brownian motions. So I assume that u epsilon is given only by one random term, you remember w epsilon was the time integral of u epsilon. Now I denote by w epsilon the time integral of this random term xi, and we know from the previous computation that it converges to w. So I simply avoid the sum over k. Instead of the sum over k, I drop the notation sum over k. And I also introduce, but maybe pay attention that I have introduced here a new notation, C epsilon, which is the time part, the random time part of u. So in a sense, the intuition that drives my ideas is that Xi epsilon converges to white noise, to the time derivative of the Brownian motion. If you want, this is the intuition behind. Xi epsilon converges to the time derivative of Brownian motion, W epsilon to Brownian motion. And let us go on with the partition. We have made here a partition of time, so we integrate on a small time interval the usual object that we brought before, and the idea is here is just a substitution. Instead of u, I brought sigma times this xi epsilon. And then I freeze time. You see here there is a time s. I freeze it to time ti, and here there is s minus ti. The frozen part will converge to ito. When we sum over the partition, the frozen part will converge to it, because we know very well the principle of Ito theory is that the function that we integrate should be frozen at the initial time of the where we take the increment of Brownian motion. The increment of Brownian motion is independent from the past, and we have to take the integrand computed at the initial time. This is the way to have the cancellation. The cancellations come from this choice. But of course, in this way, here we have S and TI, the increment in time. So now, in the next slides, we analyze term, which remains. So we have this term that we analyze. In 2 minutes, we will make the break. So let us read again this term. There is the sum over the partition. We have put the derivative of the test function to avoid difficulties of regularity, and the solution theta of the heat equation is computed at two very nearby points S and TI, and is multiplied by this object which is an approximation of the time derivative of Brownian motion. So it's a very regular object. So in a sense, if I should tell myself, is this expression easy or difficult? It is intricate, difficult, because this is an increment in time, and an increment in time usually is small. But this one is an approximation of derivative of Brownian motion, which is infinite. So there is a product of something which is almost infinite and something which is almost zero. And so we have to understand this product, how it behaves. And the way is to take the increment in time of theta from the equation of theta. So we how to handle the increment in time of theta? We take the equation. The point is that when we take the equation and replace the equation inside the identity, the differential operators, the differential operators of the equation are inserted again, a second time. So there was the differential operator. Let me cancel, there are too many things now for the discussion. There was the differential operator already in this expression, and now we put a second time inside here the same differential operator. This is the origin of the iterated second of the this iteration of the differential operator. But let me stop because it is the right time, and we make a little break, 5 minutes as usual.
Okay, thank you very much. So are there any questions up to now? Okay, if not, maybe we take a 5 minute break. Is that okay?
Thank you.
Okay, so see you in 5 minutes.
Very good. Thank you. Excellent.
Okay, so is it fine for you?
Very good, yes.
Okay, so then please start again.
Thank you very much. And of course, this part is a bit technical with many formulae, many indexes because of the partition, etc. So it's not easy to follow details. Please just try to follow the general idea, and the general idea, in a sense, is described in this slide. There was a transport term with this differential operator sigma grad, first order differential operator of transport type sigma grad, with this freezing of the time ti, we isolated an Itô integral, and the Itô integral will have good cancellation properties. It remains the increment of theta between time s and time ti, that due to the differential equation of theta brings inside again the differential operator, the transport sigma grad. The sigma grad transport comes again a second time, and they are multiplied, sigma grad at the end. This is described in the next slides, but the slides becomes more and more full of notation. So if you have time, please take the notes and you read the details with more quiet time, or the original paper where that is mentioned in the notes, where there is the full proof. But the full proof is a little bit demanding for me, for instance. It's not my paper, it's a paper of one of my collaborators. And here, let me just go fast on these slides, which explain the point. We replace the increment of theta by two terms. One term was this, and the other term contained the Laplacian. So there was a Laplacian. It is this, because it is interpreted integration by part, and the other contained the Laplacian. This is the underline. The first line, theta minus theta, at two different times, is given by the sum of two terms. Accept, please, that with some effort, this goes to zero. So the second term, this second term goes to zero. And the first term is the one which requires additional work to understand. But the key point is that here there is this iterated derivatives. If you remember the form of the additional operator L, the additional operator L is the sum over k, 1/2 sum over k of this operator, sigma grad, and so we, in a sense, we have understood the origin of this second order operator. Now, of course, one should prove that we can take the limit, and the limit is correct. So the next slides takes again this part, which is the most difficult to understand. It is difficult because you see here, there is this xi which approximates white noise. You remember that these are approximations of the time derivative of Brownian motion, and we have them twice. So it's quite demanding to understand the limit of this object. It is very good because here we have our second order differential operator, but still there is something to do. The idea again is to freeze r into the initial time plus a remainder. And this time the remainder goes to zero. It is the same trick that we applied before. Already before, we froze the time to the initial time ti of the small interval. And the frozen part converges to it. And the remainder was still alive, very important, before. Now, when we freeze the time and we do correctly the computation, the remainder goes to zero, fortunately. And so it remains to understand this term. This term, and this is a very important object in stochastic analysis. So it is rewritten here, and I inserted again the sum over k, just to conclude the proof, not to write things twice. So now I reinsert the sum over k. I reinsert the notation sigma k. And the previous computation done with k would produce k and k prime. So the you see here we would have sigma grad with different k's. The theta are frozen at the initial time interval. And therefore we have these time integrals on small time integrals of this object which approximate white noise. And the point is that these time integrals converge. This is the famous quadratic variation property. Quadratic variation property of Brownian, it's analogous to the famous quadratic variation property of Brownian motion. This increments, the square of these increments converge either to zero or to t, the length of the time interval. To zero if k and k prime are different. If we are dealing with two independent Brownian motions, it converges to zero. If we are dealing with the same Brownian motion, the quadratic variation converges to t. And therefore, this sum converges to the integral. Let me clean a little bit here, there are too many things. To the integral of what? This part is this part, but there is the delta Dirac which cancels k different from k prime. And this part collapsed just in ds. I forgot to rewrite this sum over k. So please think that there is this sum over k written here in front. So in front there is the sum over k, but k and k prime. So I noticed that I made a few mistakes. There is the here, they are really minor, but here the sum is over k and k prime, k and k prime, not only over k. So it's a sum over double index k and k prime. And this sum should be rewritten here. And then the terms k different from k prime disappears, and we find the final result. The final result, end of the proof, is that we started from this transport part. There are also the other parts of the equation, but there is. We started from this transport part. We isolated a neato part with the first trick of freezing the time integral, then analyzing the remainder converged to this iterated differential operator. And so at the end, summarizing, there is one half here, It is here, but I forgot to rewrite. The differential operator is 1/2 the sum of this iterated sigma k, sigma k. Very good. I hope I convinced myself and everybody that this second order operator is not a mathematical trick of probabilists who like Stratonovich, but it comes from the equation, the original equations, if one makes the correct arguments. Here in this slide, we rewrite the differential operator in a divergence form, because it's useful and interesting. It comes from the fact that the sigma k are divergence free. The divergence of sigma k is equal to zero. And therefore, this sigma k outside can be put inside. It is correct. What I said is correct, but it's not here. This sigma k that is rewritten here, so this sigma k is just rewritten here. This is just the same identity written component wise, but we can put this inside thanks to the fact that the divergence is zero. It's a very elementary computation. But the point is that when we put inside, we also put inside the summation. Also put inside the summation, and we have this new object which erases. This new object which erases the summation over k of sigma k I, sigma k j, components I and j of the vector, and it's nice to interpret this summation. So in this slide, I took the Stratonovich or Wanzakai corrector. Sorry that I forgot for all the slides a factor 1/2 in front of everything. I'm very sorry, I don't know why. I took this operator, I used the divergence free property to put something inside the derivative, and there is this new object sum over k to be interpreted, and is interpreted in the next slide. We have to go back to our noise. You remember our Brownian motion W, depending on time and space, was defined as the sum over k of sigma kx W kt. We put this Brownian motion here with two different space points, xy. So we computed the so-called covariance. Is a matrix valued function, the covariance, because w is a vector valued, and so we have to take the tensor product vector vector. And this produces a matrix, so Q is a matrix. It's an elementary exercise to check the validity of this identity. This matrix XY is given by this sum of sigma k computed at X and Y. And therefore, what was in the previous slide inside here is precisely what we have found now, is Q component IJ, computed on the diagonal. Namely, the covariance function is computed in two different points, x, y. But in the differential operator appears computed in the diagonal, xx, the same position x. The differential operator depends only on x, one space variable, xx. And this differential operator is elliptic, elliptic, when you have a matrix Q, the ellipticity means doing Qij, Xi, Xij, where Xi, Xij are the components of a vector. And this sum, a very elementary manipulation using the definition of Q here above, gives this, which is greater or equal than zero. So it's always greater. So this is always elliptic. Elliptic in the weak sense, greater or equal to zero. Hopefully it could be strongly elliptic, strictly greater than zero, but in general is only elliptic. Now, this completes today, because next week we go back to the equation of heat, of temperature, to prove a theorem. Until now, we have only shown that the heat equation with a noise depending on epsilon, smooth noise depending on epsilon, converges to a heat equation with heatotherm plus a correcting term. And we set the additional sentences. Next time we go back to the same equation and same more. But now I want to shift to Navier-Stokes equation and try to discuss the same topic for Navier-Stokes. In which sense? Instead of the temperature, I take the velocity of Navier-Stokes. So instead of temperature, theta, I use the velocity u of Navier-Stokes. But this immediately is a conflict. The u that was the random process, and now there is another u. What are these two u, the two velocities u? And so we try to introduce this idea of internal modeling by using this Stratonovich term, the sentences of this slide are repetitions of something that I probably already said, so drop these sentences. Let's go to the next slide, but we have understood that we move from transport equation to the Navier-Stokes equation. So the idea is the following one, large and small scales. This is one of the most common ideas in fluid dynamics. So it's not something that is discovered or introduced just now. It's one of the most classical ideas of fluid dynamics, namely to split the velocity in a part which is large scale and a part which is small scale. If you want to have a mental image, think to the wind outside my window or outside your window. The wind goes with a certain mean velocity. There is a mean velocity of the wind. And we feel the wind in many ways. If we put a flag, the flag moves because of the stays the flag because of the wind. So I think you have a flag and we see the flag because there is a wind. But this wind provokes vortices when it meets obstacles like trees, houses, etc. And we really see the vortices sometimes. But sometimes we look to the in our garden and we see things which moves because of these vortices. So there are large scale motion like this one, and small scale motions here and there due to the vortices. So this idea is absolutely natural, common, etc. The problem is that a precise subdivision is impossible. The fluid is multi-scale. It's not that there is only large and small scales very well separated. It's not like statistical mechanics in which there is the microscopic view of molecules and thermodynamics looks to average, and there is in some sense nothing in the middle. In a fluid, there is everything in the middle, between the small and the large. So it's multiscale and very complex. There is one way to cut artificially, but it's precise, a precise way to cut, that is the following one. Projections. We introduced already the projections pi n in previous lectures, so I don't recall what they are, but if we take the velocity fluid and project on a finite number of Fourier modes, we have a projection. And this projection corresponds to the idea of isolate large scales. So one way to introduce the large scales is by projection in Fourier. Another way is this other kind of projection, mollification. Since I will not use later, I just leave as it is. People know what is mollification. If we take a mollifier, this is like a projection. Because think to a profile which is very, very complicated. If you apply a mollifier, you see the same profile, but much smoother. So it's like extracting the large structures from a very complicated profile, taking this. But this approach of projecting, I will not follow this approach, even if perhaps this is the best, perhaps I will not follow because of mathematical difficulties, namely the equations for these projections contains difficulties that today I still don't handle so well. They are difficult. And so I do another thing that sorry, the slide is full of notations. It requires a few minutes to understand, but it's not difficult. I do another thing. I always have in mind that U bar are large scales and U prime are small scales, okay? But I do not define large and small from the solution. I do not take the solution and extract the large and small. I write a new system of differential equations for a pair of variables. The interpretation is that they are large and small, but this is mathematically a new system which is completely equivalent to the original Navier-Stokes system. So this is a completely equivalent formulation of the original system using two variables instead of one. And the way is described here. The time derivative of the U-bar is transport, sorry, the U-bar is transported, there is a pressure, is diffused, the U bar, and there is a forcing on the U bar. The same for U prime. U prime is transported, there is a pressure, there is diffusion, and there is a forcing on the U prime. All of them are divergence free and zero at the boundary. The U bar has its own initial condition, the U prime has its own initial condition. And below, sorry that it's not easy to put everything on the screen in a single slide in this way, the initial condition U of the full Navier-Stokes system is splitted in the U bar zero plus U prime zero. The forcing is splitted. So the only, here there is projection. If you want, here there is projection. Namely, I take the forcing, I take the initial condition, and I project. I isolate the large scales and the small scales of force and initial condition. But then I leave the system to go spontaneously from them.
And as you have seen, a very critical issue is that the field which transports U bar and U prime is the full field, U bar plus U prime. The same field, U bar plus U prime, transports U bar and transports U prime. Well, this is a mathematical model, mathematical equation, and it is equivalent to the original one. It's very easy. I mean, of course, to prove a theorem of equivalence, one has to write function spaces to say, assume that U bar, U prime are in these function spaces, then forget about function spaces, which are details. If you have a solution U bar, U prime of the system, just taking the sum, and the same for the pressure, the sum satisfies the original Navier-Stokes. So the solution of the original Navier-Stokes is rigorously the sum of the solutions of these two components. And one can also state a vice versa, but let me drop the vice versa. This kind of trick of splitting the solution of Navier-Stokes in two parts in a rigorous way, is not new. So for instance, I've seen it used for decades in the framework of point vortices in dimension two. So I mean, it's a well-known approach that sometimes is useful, And the advantage with respect to projections indicated in the previous slide is that this system, the equations of this system, are slightly easier. They are coupled only in this part. This is the only part which couples the two equations. U bar moves with transport and diffusion in its own, U prime in transport and diffusion in its own. Both of them are transported by the complete velocity fluid. Okay. The big open question that I cannot solve, let me say which is the big open question that I cannot solve. I cannot prove to which extent, the large and small scales remain large and small scales, namely, At the initial time, I impose here below, that the velocity is splitted in large scales and perturbation. I do the same on the forcing term. So I project initial condition and forcing term. Then I leave them to evolve with this system. Of course, there is a corruption. The small scales corrupt the large corrupt the small, because this transport relates the two equations. So the question is, the splitting of the initial condition is maintained a little bit, at least for short time, or immediately for positive time, the small scales becomes completely interlaced with the others, and the large scale completely interlaced. I don't know. So in the previous slide, there was a projection. If we take the velocity field and project on the first three Fourier components, it remains projected on the three Fourier components forever. So it's larger scales forever by definition, but the equations is complicated. If we do this, we have a system which is much less complicated, but the two components corrupt each other, and it's not very clear if this corruption is small or large. But let us accept this corruption and go on. And this is part of the research that I still have to understand, and people still have to understand. Let us accept this corruption. Go on. Sorry, I didn't jump any transparency. This slide is just to relax a little bit, and then we go back to this harder formula. This is just to say, if we have a boundary, Near the boundary, there is this turbulent fluid. Far from the boundary, here, the fluid is much less. Here, the fluid is much less turbulent. So, in a sense, if we go back to our first, if we connect all our lectures, we could say that U prime that I have introduced is very active near the boundary. The U bar that I have introduced is everywhere. Everywhere there is this U bar, the big structure, the big motion. Near the boundary, this U prime is very active. But this is just for interpretation. So this slide is just to relax. It's not strictly speaking necessary. So let me go back to this system where there is U bar and U prime which evolve separately, except for the coupling due to this, this transport term. And now we introduce a big simplification. I said that this system is equivalent to the true Navier-Stokes, but now I drop the equivalence by introducing a big simplification, which is this. I replace the second equation by this. The first equation is the same. The first equation is the same as the first equation. But the second equation is replaced. Let us read together in detail the replacements. Sorry if I clean a little bit. The replacements are the time derivative of U prime is maintained. Then the pressure is maintained, it doesn't matter. The viscosity is maintained. But I eliminate the this transport part, which, however, of course, is very important, and I replaced by this model discussed today in the first minutes. Namely, we are at the boundary. This is the reason, if you want, of this relaxing picture, that we are near the boundary. Near the boundary, I use this simplified model of U prime. Simplified model of U prime is Stokes with addition of a lot of vortices and subtraction of energy, otherwise the energy goes up. We have to subtract by some dissipation. And so put away things. And so this equation, you see, you recognize that this equation is the equation that we have studied today for 1 hour, in the sense this is the equation for it was called the U epsilon before. U epsilon of the first hour was the solution of this equation, which converges to white noise. The U epsilon, which now is called U prime. Before U epsilon was before in this lecture. Now U prime. But it's the same. They satisfy the same equation. It's just a change of name because I need to change the name because now I have a velocity field which is split into two components. I have to change the name. This U epsilon enters, key point, enters here, multiplied by the gradient of U bar. So you see that the small scale component act on the large scale component as a transport term, as an additional transport term, precisely like in the heat equation. Just to avoid misunderstanding, this is not due to the simplification of this equation. This was already there here. The small scale act on the large scale as an additional transport term. It's already there in the previous slides. Simply, now we simplify the equation of the small scales and apply the same principle of von Zakai and Stratonovich. And therefore, here is the summary. This one is the equation for large scales written in the previous slide, two, three slides, where the small scales act in a transport way. The small scales by themselves are given by this equation with epsilon, du prime equal, and there is 1 over epsilon. And so this u prime depends on epsilon. I don't add the notation, but u prime depends on epsilon. We take the limit when epsilon goes to zero, ideally, because to be honest, precise results already in the literature. Okay, there will be something in the next slide, but we take ideally the limit when epsilon goes to zero, and we find this equation similarly to the heat, in which there are the all terms are the same, but there is this additional elliptic operator and this Ito noise. If you want the sum of these two terms, this term and this term, are precisely like in the case of the heat equation, the result of taking the limit with the Wong Zakai philosophy that there is a corrector, etc., etc. And so we end up with this new equation. This is a new equation of Navier-Stokes type, which has a lot of features. I hope that in the next slide it is repeated. No, so I have to comment here. Sorry, it is not repeated. This new equation has the same feature of the Navier-Stokes equation, except that there is an additional viscous term, an additional elliptic operator, and an Ito noise of transport type. Associated to that equation, there is the deterministic equation in which I drop the Ito term. It's not obtained simply by average, because this is nonlinear. In the case of the heat equation, I just took the average, the Ito term disappears, and I find an equation for the average. Here, this equation is not for the average. This is a new equation that I introduce, this new equation, which is the same equation of the previous slide with this additional elliptic operator, but without the Ito term, without the Ito term. And there is a question mark in the sense, are they related? In the case of the linear equation, they are related. In the case of the nonlinear, are they related? Essentially, the answer will be that in dimension two, they are related. We can find a suitable noise in dimension two, such that the solution U of the equation of the previous slide, let me just show which one, the one which is surrounded in red, the solution U bar of this equation is close to the solution capital U of this deterministic equation. So the same idea that I described for the heat equation holds for the Navier-Stokes. And the question here above in the title is this realistic? Yes, this is the concept of eddy viscosity, which is observed in the real world. That is, when there is a turbulence, the viscous properties increase. There is an additional there is an additional viscosity in the system due to turbulence. So the idea of modeling small scales, large scales, replace the small scales by noise and do all this story, applied to the Navier-Stokes equation, explains the concept of eddy viscosity and turbulence. But this only in dimension two. In dimension three, we are not able to control the same mathematics. Let me complete with a few slides. So in a sense, I already said what is important, but there are other five slides, so please relax. there are new elements in these five slides, but in a sense, I already said what is important, and next lecture, we put more material on this, on this idea that small scale, large scale, the noise, and the additional second order elliptic operator. But let me add some discussion just to complete the lecture in these five slides. This discussion requires the new concepts that I never introduced until now. In the lectures, I mean, very old concepts in fluid mechanics, but I never introduced. The vorticity first. The vorticity is the curl of the velocity. In dimension two, if the fluid moves into this plane, the vorticity is omega, is perpendicular to the plane. So it can be described by a scalar instead of a vector, because the direction of the vector is always the same. So you can use just the intensity of this vector as a scalar, and the formula is this simplified one. So that is the concept of vorticity in fluid dynamics, which is fundamental. And with some algebra of differential operators, so one can write an equation for the vorticity. It's not clear, I mean, it's an equation which contains the velocity. The velocity appears in the equation of the vorticity. And the equation of the vorticity, let me start with dimension two first, which is easier. In the equation of the vorticity, there is the usual transport structure, time derivative of the vorticity, plus u grad vorticity, which is the material derivative. No? This today I interpreted as material derivative, transport. And this transport is balanced by the diffusion of vorticity and possibly some forcing term. In three dimensions, which is here, there is the same, but in addition, there is a term called stretching. It's algebraic. If you do the computation, there is this term in addition. It is called stretching because if one has a time to think about for a few hours, understand that this term is responsible for increase of the vorticity, elongation of the vorticity. The transport term in dimension two, which exists also in dimension three, the transport just move the vorticity around. This vorticity vector in two dimensions just move. If the fluid moves, this vector moves, but does not increase. It could increase because of the forcing, of course. Forget about the forcing. It could decrease because of the viscosity, but cannot increase. In three dimensions, it can increase. This provokes increase of the vorticity omega. And this is dramatic. If you want, at the end of the story, this is the source of the open problem for 3D Navier-Stokes. The fact that we don't know today if the 3D dynamic Stokes is globally well posed in a certain sense, is because of this physical phenomena that the stretching that could produce increase of the vorticity. Well, why I introduced the vorticity? Because we could make a variant of the talk of today and next time. Today and next time I speak of transport noise in heat equation and Navier-Stokes written with velocity. But one could do a variant. One could take Navier-Stokes written with vorticity and introduce the idea of small scales, large scales, and transport noise on the vorticity. One can do that. In dimension two, if we do that, we have the transport term and an additional transport by small scales, by the small scales, exactly like in the previous discussion today. Exactly like. So dimension two, vorticity is like today, what I discussed today until now. If we do this splitting of the small scales, large scales. And at the end, this is always dimension two, and at the end, we reach this equation with Stratonovich noise that can be rewritten as additional linear operator plus Itô noise. And this equation is already the deterministic without the Itô noise. And one can prove that the solution omega bar of this stochastic equation is close to the solution capital omega of this deterministic equation. And so the things that I described until a few minutes ago for other equation move to the vorticity formulation in dimension two. We can discuss the same problem in dimension three. And here there is a big novelty. In dimension three, as I already stressed, there is the stretching term, which is very critical. So if we take transport plus stretching, algebraically there is a minus, transport minus stretching, and we put noise in place of U. So the idea is that U is replaced by U bar plus U prime. And this U prime is replaced by noise. Okay, this is the idea of all this lecture. And so you see, the U here and here is replaced by U bar plus noise, plus noise. This is considered the correct model by many people. For instance, by Daryl Holm and by others, this is considered the correct model if you want to put a noise inside the vorticity equation. Unfortunately, the link with this three-dimensional deterministic equation is unproved, is not understood. In dimension two, it is understood. In dimension three, this is a big open problem. So let me repeat. If we take three dimension at the level of vorticity, we make this replacement here discussed today. Namely, we replace U by U bar plus U prime, and then we replace U prime by noise. we get this system, which appears nowadays in several papers by several authors, for instance, the group of Daryl Holm. And but we have a theorem also with Daryl, we wrote papers, etc. We have theorems, but of existence, local existence of something, but the link with this deterministic equation, which is a key aspect of my final two lectures now in Tokyo, this link is not understood, is a big open problem. On the contrary, with Dejun Luo, that is in the audience, that we already discussed a little bit last time about this topic, we have made a simplification, and with this simplification, we understood something. The simplification from the physical viewpoint is not completely clear, so please take it as a mathematical result, which may be perhaps a first step, we understand this simplification, and maybe in the future we can do the full problem. Which is the simplification? We take dimension three. We replace, as above, u by u bar plus u prime. And therefore, we have u bar in the transport plus stretching. But when we go to the u prime, we do not put the noise in the stretching. We just put the noise in the transport. Just transport noise. And it is this term. Sum over k, sigma k grad omega bar times the noise, times in the sense of Stratonovich. We need, technically speaking, we need this projection on divergence free field. We have to introduce the projection on divergence free field because the equation otherwise is incorrect. Namely, the sum of all other terms is divergence free, and so also the additional term written here should be divergence free. So with the projection, there is a balance, all of them are divergence free. Without the projection, there is an identity between something that is divergence free and something which is not divergence free. Such an identity is an equation without any solution, because it's an equation with a contradiction. So we have to take that projection. The projection is not necessary. This is the previous equation. In the previous equation here, when we introduce the noise both in the transport and in the stretching, the projection is not necessary because that term is already divergence free. This is a difficult rules of differential calculus. The equation written in this slide that I show are correct without projection because the terms are already equilibrated divergence free. If we drop the stretching, if we go here, we drop the stretching term for the noise, just for the noise, and we maintain only the noise in the transport, then we need this projection. This is also a signature of the fact that the model is slightly artificial, but can be a first step. And now it is true that there is a rigorous link with this three-dimensional deterministic equation. With this simplification, the rigorous link is true. Let me stress this deterministic three-dimensional equation. It is a classical here also here, the old Laplacian. It is classical also in this difficult stretching term, deterministic, but the novelty is the presence of this additional elliptic operator. So it is a deterministic three-dimensional differential equation, three-dimensional Navier-Stokes equation, three-dimensional Navier-Stokes equation with an additional second-order differential operator. And this is a great success because the fact that there is a rigorous link between the stochastic model and this equation is a great success because one can prove in our paper, we proved the solution omega of the stochastic Navier-Stokes equation is close to the solution capital omega of the deterministic Navier-Stokes with increased dissipation. This I already said, but which is the consequence of this? The consequence, this implies the well-posedness is improved by noise because the deterministic equation with increased dissipation has a better well-posedness. More, somewhere here is written, the highest is the dissipation in Navier-Stokes, the better is the well-posedness. We have constructed a model with noise, which is close to a deterministic Navier-Stokes with increased dissipation. So this model, this stochastic model, hereditates some property. We have proved rigorously that it hereditates some property of well-posedness. And so it is better posed. This is in the framework of the theory regularization by noise that we mentioned sometime during the discussions in these days. Essentially, it is the first true result of regularization by noise for the three-dimensional Navier-Stokes equation. The previous results couldn't be called a regularization by noise in the full sense. This is the first one. Is a result of regularization by noise, in, let's say, in the full sense, because it improves well-posedness. The model is a simplified model because the noise is only in the transport part and not in the stretching. So there is still research to be done. In 3 minutes, my talk is over. I have only the last slide. Is a summary, the summary. I have 2 slides. This summary is very dense because it's more than a summary. So perhaps even if we cannot read all, we can continue next time to read the summary. First sentence, in this chapter, we started to discuss transport noise. But there is a transport stretching noise that I anticipated in 3D, and this is less understood. So there is an open problem of the stretching noise that should be understood better. We understood the Wanzakai and the origin of the elliptic operator. The origin of this elliptic operator, we understood this fundamental, is thanks to this elliptic operator, there is a regularization by noise. So it's, this is why I spent so much time on Wanzakai, because if we miss, if we take that for granted, it seems a trick. It seems a people of analytical, not probabilistic, fluid mechanics could say, okay, you start with Stratonovich noise, which includes an elliptic operator, and so you solve a priori the problem because you put an additional elliptic operator. Yes, I do that, but because by Wanzakai, this emerges spontaneously. It's not an artifact of stochastic analysis. It's a spontaneous emergence from limit of smooth fields. In the case of heat transport, everything is slightly classical and easy and leads to eddy dissipation. In the case of a fluid, internal structure of the fluid is something more modern, maybe not completely understood. It relates to large and small scales and stochastic modeling on small scales. In two dimensions, it explains the concept of eddy viscosity, which is true in experiments. So even if the modeling is still not clear, it leads to a realistic result. And so there is something deep. Turbulence enhances the viscosity of the fluid. This is something deep and true. But in 3D, we do not understand equally well. We understand only something. We understand the transport noise, not the stretching noise. We understand the transport noise. If we limit ourselves to what we understand, namely the transport noise, this is very successful. It improves the theory of 3D Navier-Stokes, in the sense that I will describe maybe also next time, of delaying the blow up of solution. Since there is an additional viscosity, the blow up is delayed or even cancelled. So necessary is a deep research to understand the stretching part, which is not yet understood. And the final, if I can use 1 minute more, the final is a very heuristic remark that I like very much. For 20 years, we tried to understand if additive perturbation have a regularizing power. We tried to prove that additive noise regularizes Navier-Stokes. At least 10 years of deep research, a little bit frustrated because we didn't find any great final result. But what I showed today is that if we put additive perturbation corresponding to the roughness of a boundary, and we put this additive perturbation in the small scales, this, by the small large scale decomposition, transfer to a multiplicative noise in the large scale. And the multiplicative noise, at least the transport, has a regularizing power. So at the end of the story, in a very complicated way, we have shown that an additive noise has a regularizing power. So even if the final theorem is the transport noise regularizes, but this transport noise comes from an additive noise in the small scales. So at the end of the story, I think that the conjecture was correct, but it's too difficult to fill in all the pieces in a single theorem. It's just, there is, I think, a very interesting intuitive picture of how the noise additive small scale produce multiplicative and then regularization. But of course, the rigorous theorem are just fragments of all this story. Thank you very much. Sorry that I took 2 more minutes, but I think that this final picture is very, very exciting, at least for me and for many friends. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Frandri. Are there any questions or comments? Kawabe-san, please.
Thank you. Hello. you had the voice closed. Close the voice. I don't hear you.
Yeah, hello. My name is Hiroshi Kawabe. So I have a question in the first part of the lecture. So you mentioned its convergence of the Stokes equation to the white noise.
Yes.
Can you say something about the speed of convergence?
For this particular model, yes, because one can control the two terms. I rewrote the solution using the mild formulation, the semigroups. I rewrote the solution of Stokes like a stochastic Ito term that goes to zero plus a term which is just a Yoshida approximation multiplied by the limit object, by the noise. So one can write something, one can make an estimate on the Yoshida approximation. This is a deterministic theory of semigroups, and one can estimate in a in the mean square, the Ito term, how is small. So I think, yes, that one can do a quantitative estimate of the closeness for this very simple model. Maybe for more difficult is more difficult, but then, yes.
I think so. So ellipticity constant coming from the vector field sigma k plays a role of the convergence. So of course, if the ellipticity constant is strictly positive, so then I think I can agree. So we can get some nice estimate. So, but so in the case of the ellipticity constant is zero case. So yes. I'm not sure what is happening.
Yes. No. I think you are right. I think you are completely right. I probably misunderstood your question. Your question is deeper than what I understood. Yeah. I understood that you spoke only of the convergence of the noise to the noise. But when we analyze Wondt-Sakai, namely the convergence of solution of the equation with the approximate noise to solution of the limit equation with the Ito plus corrector, the ellipticity constant of the noise plays an important role in this convergence. And so this is a very deep remark. There is a recent paper by Umberto Pappalettera that is mentioned in my notes. I think that some information is there, but this is a very important remark with several things that should be done more. So thank you, very deep remark.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, yes. Thank you very much. The ellipticity constant of the noise is a very interesting concept inside this kind of theorems, yes.
So any other questions or comments? So roughly saying, I think that you started from the large friction equation of the Stokes problem with noise. And roughly saying, you multiply the epsilon to the both sides. Then you very roughly, heuristically, you get the U equal the other noise term. I think the other terms has the epsilon in front, if you yes. multiply.
Yes, I understand.
It's quite heuristic, but I think U equal, so lemma one.
Yes, correct.
Okay, correct. Yeah, just you multiply the epsilon to the both sides.
Right. Thank you very much. Sorry, I interrupt you. Just to say to everybody with the blackboard, what you say. The equation was the equation was d u epsilon to simply let me simplify minus one over epsilon u epsilon dt plus one over epsilon. dW and exactly as you say, this means that essentially this part is zero, and so dropping epsilon u epsilon dt should be like dW. Otherwise, there is. I think this is what they would say probably.
Oh, yeah.
But that's very good intuition. I didn't notice very good intuition.
And I think you will explain next time the omega bar is close to capital omega or the...
Sorry. Yes. This requires a number of computations. So it was only announced and is not. And in particular, I'm sure that I created a misunderstanding. I apologize for that. Is not always close. It depends on the noise, namely omega bar. In some sense, omega, the deterministic in some sense is like the average. So we have a stochastic object, we have a deterministic one that in the linear case is the true average. In the nonlinear case is not the true average, but intuitively is like the average. And of course, it's not always true that the stochastic is close to the average. So it's only under some assumption on the noise that they are close. And this fact that is only under some assumption on the noise, I didn't stress. So next time I will clarify very well in which scaling limit of the noise the stochastic part, the solution of the stochastic problem is close to the solution of the deterministic.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So actually I once derived some stochastic Navier-Stokes equation with transport type noise actually, but the derivation is very different what you discussed today. I considered some variational problem and then derived something very similar to the object which you discussed today. But in our case, it's very, very simple. And we didn't study the existence and uniqueness, but afterward, Yokoyama and also Stannard actually gave us some meaning to that step.
It is really a pity and a mistake, of course, from me to forget this work. Both you and also Bresniak, Zapinski and others did long time ago some extremely important works that remained a little bit isolated. And I forget to mention them, but they were fundamental. In your case, I think that you anticipated what the group of Daryl Holm and other, also Annabella Cruzeiro nowadays, etc., are doing now, namely a variational formulation that, and with this variational formulation nowadays, they find exactly this kind of result. And you anticipated this many years ago. Similarly, with Bresniak and Zapinski, 25 or 30 years ago, we wrote a paper with a transport noise that was completely forgotten, in which we explained the transport noise at the Lagrangian level. We gave a justification at the Lagrangian level. And this was also another motive that I raised again recently to justify transport noise at the Lagrangian level. So thank you for the remark, and sorry that I forgot to mention.
Our case was very simple.
I remember very well. It was,
I think Annabella also Cruzeiro, also she did something that's slightly different, but starting from the variational problem, she also derived some transport type noise.
Yes. In a sense, your paper, like the one of Bresniak, etc., were too early, so to speak. Mm-hmm. The community was not mature enough to take them. Then, as it happens, sometimes we forget, and then we rediscover.
our method was very, very primitive, and nothing important, I think.
Yes, and now there is a long paper of Cruzeiro, Zambrini, and Razio, on the variational geometric mechanics, variation approach, some years ago of Daryl Holm and many papers later of Daryl Holm and his students. So this variational approach now is very considered very challenging. And you anticipated many years ago, I remember very well.
our method was very primitive. Your method looks a bit different, but
it's different,
totally different.
Yes.
But the idea, maybe something behind, has some common ideas. I think because you consider the fluid mechanical particles perturbed by some randomness in a sense. Maybe I don't understand that quite well.
Let me follow Daryl Holm intuitions of these years, because sometimes I speak with him and I like very much his viewpoint. Daryl Holm likes very much the geometric mechanics, mm-hmm. and so developed this multiplicative noise transport and stretching coming from the geometric mechanics. The original time that he developed this was precisely Lagrangian. The intuition, okay, it was geometric mechanics, but I think that behind there was the Lagrangian idea in the mind. Later on in one paper, he used the geometric mechanics in connection with the model reduction, which is model reduction is something related to large and small scales. So also the geometric view that you mentioned, this variational, also this variational view that you mentioned can be related to the idea of larger scale, small scale in some sense. Mm-hmm. I'm not able to understand, I cannot explain. I just mentioned that some people wrote paper on the viewpoint of Lagrange, very recently, 1 or 2 years ago, the Lagrangian viewpoint, the variational viewpoint, which is also sometimes called the geometric mechanics, variational viewpoint related to model reduction, large scale, small scale. So at the end, everything is related, you are right. Very difficult to have the full mind on this problem. Everything is related.
Thank you very much. So are there any other questions or comments? Okay, so maybe there is no more questions today. So thank you very much, Professor Frandori.
Thank you. We see you in 1 week.
Yes.